Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel.
In a previous video, we have seen conventional PN junction photodiode and a PIN photodiode. In our today's lecture, we are going to study here the avalanche photodiode, in that principle, construction, working, advantages, disadvantages and applications of avalanche photodiode. Then after that, in second point, signal degradation, in that we are going to study attenuation, absorption, scattering losses and radiative losses. So this is our today's agenda. So let us start with the first avalanche photodiode.
Avalanche photodiode or APD, as we know that in a case of conventional photodiodes and PIN photodiodes, the output current is very small. This is because these photodiodes are having a limited gain. Now in order to obtain the large gain, that is large output, the avalanche photodiodes are used. So see here the principle of operation. In this case, the reverse bias is applied to the photodiode which is near to the breakdown value. Then the incident light produces the electron hole pairs. Now these carriers are travels with their saturation velocity and they will collide with the lattice. So new electron hole pairs are generated, which are travels along with the initial carriers. Thus the multiplication of charge carriers takes place, which increases the current. So this process of generating more number of charge carrier is called as impact ionization. This is the key process for the avalanche photodiode. Okay, next is the construction. The construction of reach through avalanche photodiode is as shown in this figure. If the silicon material is used, then the efficiency is about 90% can be obtained. It is a P plus pi PN plus configuration. We can see P plus pi PN N plus configuration is present. Here P layer is having high resistivity. This is the P layer which is having high resistivity. So all the reverse bias is mostly applied across this P and N plus region. When the applied reverse bias is increased, then the width of depletion region is also increased. Okay, so after that, let us see how it will work. The reverse bias is applied here as shown in this figure. Here the negative terminal of battery is connected to P plus region and the positive terminal of battery is connected to N plus region. When the light is incident on the top P plus layer, here the top P plus layer is present, then the electron hole pairs are generated. More number of electron hole pairs are generated in the pi layer. The charge carriers moves with their saturation velocity because of the applied electric field, and the lower P and N plus region is highly resistive region. Now the electrons will travel into highly resistive region. So here the impact ionization takes place to this P and N plus area. That means a new charge carriers are generated in the high resistive region. Then for this we required here electric field, and the required electric field for the impact ionization is from 10^4 volt per centimeter to 10^5 volt per centimeter. Thus the multiplication of charge carrier takes place. This will increase the total photocurrent. Sometimes it will increase the gain up to 200. Here the important factor is that the material should not have any defects. If such defects are present, then the total photocurrent will get reduced. Okay, so make sure that the material is proper without any defect. Next is to study the different parameters of avalanche photodiode. In case of avalanche photodiode, to do the impact ionization, the required energy is more than that of band gap energy of a material. So the different parameters related to this process are as follows. The first is here impact ionization coefficient. To do the impact ionization process, the coefficients related to electrons and holes are termed as alpha E and alpha H. The electron and the holes have to travel a definite distance to create the new electron and hole pairs in the impact ionization process. And this distance traveled by electrons and holes is the direction of electric field. So the reciprocal of the average distance is called as ionization coefficient. So it is defined as here. The ionization coefficient we can also define as number of secondary electron hole pairs per unit length. That is alpha is equal to number of secondary electron hole pairs divided by unit length. Next is the response time. This is the total time period which will taken by a photodiode to generate the photocurrents. In the case of a valence photodiode, the gain provided by this impact ionization process is very large. So here the bandwidth is reduced because a definite time period is required by electron and holes to do the impact ionization process. Thus the response time will be more. So here if the ratio of alpha E divided by alpha H is equal to 1, that means if ionization coefficients for both the electron and the holes is same, then the both electron and the hole starts to do the impact ionization. So here the time requirement is more. That means bandwidth, which is reciprocal of time period, gets reduced. But if alpha E divided by this alpha H tends to as, then time period is minimized. Okay. Third is the threshold ionization energy. This is the minimum amount of energy which is required to do the impact ionization. It's called as threshold ionization coefficients. Fourth parameter is multiplication coefficients. In the case of a valence photodiode, after the impact ionization process, the number of electron and holes are increased. That means a multiplication of charge carrier takes place. Thus the multiplication coefficient is defined as the ratio of output current to the input current. Here the current is related to the number of electrons and holes, and the multiplication coefficients for electrons and holes are denoted by M of E and M of N. Here M of E is equal to IEO upon IEI, and M of H is equal to I of NO divided by I of NI. So here this IEO and IENO is equal to output currents of electrons and holes respectively, and I of EI and I of NI are the input current related to electrons or hole respectively. Okay, so these are the parameters of a valence photodiode. After that, here some noise mechanism is also present in APD. In case of a valence photodiodes, mainly there are three types of noise signals. The first is short noise, second thermal noise, and third avalanche noise. So see here, short noise. This noise is basically from the primary currents, such as photocurrent, dark current, and background current. Here, as we know that the dark current means the in the absence of light, the light is generated, the some amount of current is generated. So here, this is called as dark current value. Since these currents are primary currents, they are not multiplied, so the value of this short noise is very small. Thus, the value of short noise is small. This current can be calculated as given here, I short is equal to under root of 2q into IPH plus IB plus ID into G square F into B, where this q is equal to charge of electron having value 1.6 into 10⁻¹⁹ कूलम. नेक्स्ट IPH फोटो करंट, IB इज द बैकग्राउंड करंट, ID इज द डार्क करंट वैल्यू, G इज द गेन ऑफ फोटो डायोड, F इज द एक्सेस नॉइज फैक्टर एंड B इज इक्वल टू बैंडविड्थ. ओके, सेकेंड इज द थर्मल नॉइज. द थर्मल नॉइज इज क्रिएटेड बिकॉज ऑफ द चेंज इन द रेजिस्टेंस वैल्यूज ऑफ द एन APD. If the resistance of APD will change, then it will definitely affect the temperature value. So here the thermal noise is generated. This is given by I thermal is equal to 4 kBTB divided by R of EQ, where KB is nothing but your Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature of photodiode, B is bandwidth, and R of EQ is equal to equivalent resistance. Third type of noise is avalanche noise. This is the main source of noise. This noise is generated because of avalanche process takes place in case of APD. In case of avalanche process, the secondary carriers are generated because of the collisions which is created by electron and holes, but the rate of generation of these secondary carrier is not fixed. So there are variation in these rates. So this will cause the variations in the number of secondary carriers generated, so thus the noise current gets generated. These variations can be minimized by making the avalanche process asymmetric. Asymmetric avalanche process means only one type of carriers, that means either electrons or holes produces the secondary charge carriers. In other way, if the ratio of electron ionization coefficient alpha E to the hole ionization coefficient alpha H is made maximum, that is up to infinity, then it is possible that the avalanche process is asymmetric and the noise will be minimized. So to reduce the avalanche noise, here we can use the condition alpha E divided by alpha H tends to infinity. So these are the noises in avalanche photodiode. After that, here the APD, which is having certain advantages, disadvantages and applications. So here in advantages, the APD which is having high sensitivity. Second advantage is that high gain is provided. Third is the speed of operation is high for the APD. Next, disadvantages. Here the balance between noise and gain is difficult to adjust. Second point is it has poor temperature stability. Third is high value of bias voltage is required for APD. And last, cost is high. Next is the applications of avalanche photodiode. Here because of the high sensitivity and high gain, here as we know that the high gain is produced due to the impact ionization process, so that these diodes are used in optical measurement system and in fiber optic communications. Okay. Next part of this video is we are going to study about the signal degradation. The signal degradation of optical fiber may be due to attenuation, that is signal loss while propagating through the fiber, and distortion of signal just like a broadening of pulse. The attenuation decides the maximum transmission distance between transmitter and receiver, and this attenuation of the signal is majorly due to absorption, scattering and radiative losses. The attenuation is measured in terms of attenuation coefficient in a decibel per kilometer, which is given by alpha is equal to 10/Z into log of P of O divided by P of Z. Here P of O is equal to optical power at the origin when Z is equal to 0, and P of Z is optical power at distance Z. And Z is nothing but the distance of fiber from origin at which attenuation is to be measured. So this alpha is also called as fiber loss or fiber attenuation. So in short, we can say that in attenuation, there is a fluctuation of signals, which will affect the amplitude. Okay. Next is the absorption process. The attenuation of signal is due to absorption is caused by three factors. The first is absorption due to atomic defects in glass composition. These losses are due to missing molecules, or we can say high density clusters of atom groups or oxygen defects in glass structure. Normally these losses are comparatively less than other two, but may become very large if exposed to ionizing radiation. Because of radiation damages internal structure of material. So these atomic defects absorbs optical energy, and the higher the radiation will produce the larger attenuation of absorption. Okay. The second is the extrinsic absorption. This attenuation losses are due to presence of impurities in the fiber material. Impurities like transition metal ions, iron, chromium, cobalt, copper, and from OH, that is from water ions. These impurities are more in direct melt fabrication process of fiber than vapor phase deposition process. So the impurity absorption losses occur due to transition of electrons between energy levels or due to charge transition between ions. So this extrinsic absorption is happened due to the presence of impurities. Next is the intrinsic absorption. This type of absorption is due to the basic fiber material SiO2. Even if no impurities or nor material distortion is present, there are losses due to the basic material, and it is the fundamental lower limit of all losses considered in the previous section. So this loss results from electronic absorption bands in ultraviolet region and from atomic vibration bands from near to infrared region. Absorption in ultraviolet region is due to photon interaction with an electron in the valence band, and absorption near IR region is due to characteristic vibration frequency of the chemical bond between the atoms. So the interaction between the vibrating bond and the electromagnetic field of optical signal transfers energy from field to the bond, giving rise to absorption. So we can say here this intrinsic absorption is can be happen due to the intrinsic property. Third is the scattering loss. Second is the scattering losses. In scattering losses, these are occur due to the small microscopic variation in the material density, and or it can be happened from the fluctuation in composition and from defects while fabrication. These variations give rise to variation in refractive index, and a variation in a refractive index causes realized scattering of the light, thereby losses in optical fiber. So this type of scattering losses reduces with increasing wavelength. Scattering losses are due to composition and from defects in fabrication is a bit complex to find because of random molecular nature and various oxide constitutes of glass. If a single component glass is considered, then scattering loss at a fixed wavelength, that is lambda, due to the density variation can be given as alpha scattering is equal to 8 pi cube upon 3 lambda raised to 4 into n square minus 1 into kb tf into bt, where kb is the Boltzmann constant, tf is the temperature at which glass was solidified, and bt is the isothermal compressibility of the material. Next is the radiative losses. These losses are due to the bending of fiber, or also called as bending losses. So there are two types. The first is micro bending losses and the second macro bending losses. In the micro bending losses, when the bending radius is less than that core diameter, then it is considered as a micro bending losses, and in macro bending losses, when bending radius is greater than the core diameter, then it is called macro bending losses. So these are here the amount of energy losses due to the radiation depends on the radius of curvature of curvature, or we can say bend. Losses due to micro bends are caused due to non-uniformities in the manufacturing of cable, or due to lateral pressure applied during cable installation. Here this loss is due to fiber curvature causing repetitive coupling of energy between the guided modes and the non-guided modes in the fiber.
In this way, we have covered signal degradation and avalanche photodiode. So we are going to end our today's session with the motivational quote. And today's motivational quote for you is, if you are working on something exciting that you really care about, you don't have to be pushed. The vision pulls you. Thank you so much.